This is State Representative Kerry Condotta. Welcome to the 12th District. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to this week's edition of the 12th District. We're going to do something a little bit different today. We're going to be talking to someone that's not so political, but the business he directs and the program that he runs is political, and we're going to tie that all together because there's changes going on that really make this even more political. You probably guessed by now, or maybe you haven't, that it is Link Transit we're going to be talking about today with our leader of Link Transit, Richard DeRock. And we're going to talk about why it's political, a little bit about the system itself, but why it's become political, and what is he doing to address that political atmosphere that goes with what he's doing. So it should be a very interesting interview. He'll be with us in just a minute. We will have Richard DeRock of Link Transit. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the 12th District. We are pleased today to have Richard DeRock here from Link Transit. I know that just doesn't sound political. How could Link be a political situation? Well, trust me, transit is a real political football, particularly in Olympia. Not maybe as much here, in a couple different ways, and we're going to talk about that in the next segment. But right now, I would like to talk about Link in general, what's going on and where it's going. Welcome, sir.
Thanks for having me.
Nice to have you aboard. Tell us a little bit about where we're going with this transit system. It looks like it's been very successful so far, but you've got some new ideas and new things coming.
Sure. So Link is doing well. We're providing about 1 million trips a year in our area here. We have 18 routes that serve the Wenatchee urbanized area, go up to Leavenworth and Chelan about 21 times a day. And those two outlying corridors, we serve Rock Island and Waterville, Malaga as well. And so provide a vital link for people that can get to work and school and home. Most of the service is for people that don't have other choices. Mm-hmm. And that's for our primary market. But it's a surprisingly large commuter service that operates in the area.
You said 21 trips. Is that both Leavenworth and Chelan combined, or
no? That's each one. So
21 trips to each place.
21 each way. One way. So actually, 42 trips a day.
My goodness, I had no idea you had that much service.
And those are our busiest commuter routes. Yeah. They move about 500 people a day out of Leavenworth, about 300 people a day out of the Chelan area down to Wenatchee and actually both directions.
Okay.
For
well,
commuting.
That's surprising to me. Okay, so. And then you have the core Wenatchee area, and then you said that you go to as far as Waterville. So Douglas County, you don't do all of Douglas County, you just do kind of the western
side. We operate in the Eastmont, Waterville, and Arondo school districts. That's okay. The boundaries in Douglas County, which is where most of the population is. And sure. So we operate, I think, 6 trips a day to Waterville and county seats. So we need to be able to get people up there to do the county seat, and that's and actually commute as well. So. Not as productive. It's a pretty small town.
But, yeah, right.
But again, that's providing that basic access that goes on to the community.
Okay.
Link is very financially stable. We've done a 20-year capital and operating plan, and we can operate the service we have today with the resources we have.
Wow, that's terrific.
So we've looked at that, looked at our finances, and we can do what we do today. The question that we've been throwing out, though, is are what we're doing today enough?
Mm-hmm.
Our community's changing. We're growing, and the traffic's beginning to build. We're beginning to see some of the urban, some of the urban things that happen. And is it time for Link to do more? to try to address some of those other issues besides that basic access and some of the minimal commute. And
what would that look like moving forward? What are you thinking?
At a fundamental level, it's pretty straightforward. It's things like Link has never operated on a Sunday. Mm-hmm. A lot of our employment works on Sundays.
Sure.
So providing access to some of the fruit sheds, providing access to some of our 24-hour-a-day employers or something that we're asking the question, should we be doing that? That's going to take more resources to do. Clearly something that we've heard is a necessity. Looking at more one-seat rides, when you don't have a lot of resources, and our funding, like I said, is stable and we're comfortable with it. We have a 4-10 sales tax that the voters improved back in 1990. Mm-hmm. But that sales tax actually is one of the lowest in the states. In transit, the average is about 7/10 for transit going in most communities. And so the question is, should we be doing more to try to provide more services to the community? So Sunday service, better Saturday. We only operate about a quarter of our system on Saturdays. Mm-hmm. Later in the evening, earlier in the morning, to allow the second and third shift people to ride transit, because right now you can't do that on our system.
What are the hours, operating hours currently?
Well, it's a little stretched because if you're going to have a bus start in Chelan or Manson and get down here by 7:30 in the morning, it means we have to be up there at 4:30. So the buses leave the yard at 4:00 in the morning, and the last one's back in at 10. But most of the system operates from about 6:30 to about 7:00 at night. So here in Wenatchee area, the service pretty much shuts down about 7.
Okay.
The last trip going to Chelan, last trip to Leavenworth, leave here about 8:00 to take people back home, mm-hmm. after the routes come back in. So, but the vast majority, probably 85% of the service ends at about 7:00 at night, which means you really can't do a second or third shift.
Sure. What is the most popular run that you have? Where is most of the...
Well, the most popular run is our Route A, which runs from Columbia Station over to the East Wenatchee Valley Mall.
Okay, and then back and forth across the
river. Back and forth the river. That one moves 400,000 people a year.
Wow.
It just pumps ridership back and forth. And that actually connects all the way out to the North Valley Mall. So our commercial core moves a ton of people.
Mm-hmm.
The next route is our Route 5, which goes up to the hospital, down 5th Street past the college, toward the Walmart.
Yeah.
So the major destinations in town, that mm-hmm. one probably 150,000 people a year. Then our Leavenworth route, about 500 people a day, and mm-hmm. Chelan route, about 300 people a day.
Are you seeing growth in that Leavenworth and Chelan route?
We haven't this last year. Transit nationwide's been shrinking a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
Nationwide ridership's down about 8%. Gasoline prices fell, and the economy's gotten shifted a bit. We weren't hit that hard. We were down last year about 1.5% over where we had been. All that seems to have turned around so far this year. We're actually up a little bit.
But we have this growth going on, too, so it probably offsets any drop in the ridership.
Well, we're hoping that's what's going on and that we're trying to be responsive to those elements. So.
And you get some big plans for Leavenworth. Aren't you putting in a new parking
ride? In fact, we're out to add right now. We got a state grant for $3.9 million to build a park and ride in Leavenworth.
Mm-hmm.
That's located behind the Safeway. So it'll be a 90-space park and ride with a driver break room. We're actually adding on to that to put a public restroom for the city of Leavenworth there, and a bypass road that allows us to get around some of the traffic at the intersection down there at Riverbend Drive, which backs up, so it'll allow us to get into the park and ride. And the purpose of this, both we need additional parking spaces to deal with the Leavenworth commute, but the other issue we have is during the Leavenworth festival seasons, our buses get really caught up in traffic and we can't be reliable.
Right.
So the idea is when traffic's bad, the buses will terminate at that park and ride and we'll have a shuttle take people to town so we can maintain schedules coming back into Wenatchee.
Oh, so you are going to have a shuttle on top of that.
Yeah.
I know that Leavenworth is fighting a tremendous parking problem.
Yes.
It's really, they've outgrown themselves badly, so this is part of the whole plan to alleviate some of that congestion.
Exactly. And the development we're part of there, there's a 29-acre development that's supposed to bring in 150 apartments and other assets.
Right.
Hotel. And so there's going to be a different demand, so our park and ride and the transit service should help mitigate some of the traffic that's there, provide options, and then in the corridor up and down Highway 2 between the park and ride at the Big Y, the park and ride, small park and ride we have in Dryden, park and rides we have in Old Station, there's about 200 parking spaces that we control in that corridor that we could actually for events, for example, run shuttle, the bus up and down, allow people to access Christmas tree, access Oktoberfest, using the
terrific.
Parking rides as a void the other side. Probably got to operate more hours to do that, but.
Well, but I tell you, a lot of people avoid Leavenworth because of the hassle up there now, and if it makes it easier, I think we might see more people from here going. Obviously, Seattle's there all the time, but our folks might have a little more fun. Well, I think that's just terrific. We're going to take a quick break, and I promised you a little bit of politics here, so I'm going to come back and talk to Richard a little bit about the politics, about further financing, and about green energy and environment, which really we are on the cutting edge of. And people on the West Side don't believe that when I tell them that, but we're going to talk a little bit about that. We'll be right back with the 12th District. Welcome back. We are with Richard Durack today from the Link Transit System, and I promised you I'd put a little politics in this show. Of course, we'd never have a show without some politics, but it's a good thing because we are leading the way. This Link Transit System, they're leading the way in a number of areas, especially on environmental issues. And I've been very proud to go to Olympia and tell our friends on the West Side that we have the leading emissions, low emissions bus system, and that's what you've been working on for the last few years. Tell us a little bit about that.
Sure. Back in 2009, we applied for and were one of three recipients nationwide of a grant, federal grant, to do electric buses. And we were looking at electric, not just for an environmental issue, but mainly for a cost advantage. With our utility rates, that seemed like a really good strategy going forward. And so we were one of the first three systems in the country to have electric buses. We're the first to have small vehicles anywhere electrically powered. And the green trolleys that people see in the downtown, those are the first electric buses that we had, actually the first electric buses on the West Coast.
Wow.
And so those have been operating now for about 7 years.
And they've had a few bumps in the road.
Oh, yeah.
That wasn't...
No, they've not been by any means trouble-free.
Right.
We've had lots of
issues.
Well,
you were first, you know. What do you expect?
Yeah, and unfortunately, that was the... You know, we'd hoped to be just leading edge. It's been bleeding edge, and that's been a challenge. But we've made them work.
Yep. And now you've got some bigger ones.
Exactly. And so we applied for another grant in 2011. We were awarded that grant for five more vehicles. Took a while with the problems we were having with the first generation. We decided to let the technology mature a bit before we bought the second group. We have five, what are called BYD, which is a Chinese company, but they have a plant in California. They actually, these are US-built vehicles. And they've been here in service since September, mainly running that busy route because we need the larger vehicle. It's a 35-foot coach, a large coach to go and run back and forth across the river, and we've been trying them on other services and see how they work.
How often do they have to be recharged?
Well, they have about a 145-mile range without being plugged in, or we have one of them that's equipped with a wireless charger, which allows us to recharge it at the bus station.
And this is new.
And that's actually the first in the world.
In the world?
In the world.
Wow.
We installed just here 3 weeks ago, the first high-powered wireless charger, 200 kilowatts, so we can move 200 kilowatts of power. And just to give you a comparison, the plug-in charger you use on a Nissan Leaf or a Prius is about 3 kilowatts.
Okay.
And so we're plugging, we're charging at 200 kilowatts for the vehicle, and it's done wireless. There's no connection. The bus pulls over the charging pad. They kneel the bus to, which we do anyway, let the people off and on the bus, and as it kneels down, it gets in range of the charger, charger kicks on, starts charging the bus.
How long does that take?
Well, the bus will sit there for about 5 minutes when it's at the terminal loading and unloading passengers. That 5 minutes will put about 3.5 to 4 kilowatts of power back into the bus, which will give us another 8 to 10 miles of range on the vehicle and allow us to run that bus all day long then. So we're not limited to that 140 miles we have on the plug-in.
So are we moving that direction on all of them eventually? You think that's
We think so. And because it's working fairly well, the vendor that put this in is a company called Momentum Dynamics out of Pennsylvania. They're the ones who invented this technology. They actually want to replace ours with their new generation, which is smaller and lighter. And they've said if we want to expand it, which it seems to be working, mm-hmm. They'll go ahead and do that at no cost to get us to the wow. better technology. So we have one bus doing it now currently. We have a grant for 5 more vehicles that has that technology mm-hmm. included in the funding. So we will have, we probably are going to retire the green trolleys here when the new ones come in. So
sure.
we'll have about 10 electric vehicles in the fleet and really trying to evaluate how many more make sense for our operation because they're expensive.
Right, and you've converted the other vehicles to propane.
Right, everything that was lighter duty, so mm-hmm. the smaller vehicles, we can't get heavy duty propane engines. I wish we could. Mm-hmm. And propane is was done mainly for a cost benefit. Mm-hmm. Propane costs us right now about 80 cents a gallon.
Wow. But
we get a 50 cent tax credit, so they're costing us 30 cents. And there was a period last year where the price had fallen down to 48 cents, so they were paying us to run the buses.
That's a great problem.
Yeah, that's a great problem. So we've done propane. We have 29 propane powered vehicles in the fleet, and the board last night approved the purchase of 9 more propane-powered vehicles. Propane works out really well from a cost perspective. It's hugely cheaper than running gasoline mm-hmm. or diesel. It's about 24% less greenhouse gas from propane, mm-hmm. and the emissions are incredibly clean. We converted our minivans, the mm-hmm. Dodge minivans that run around town for carrying people with disabilities. Well, we were the first persons to do that, so we had to have them certified at the EPA. And the EPA came back and said they actually are certifying our minivans as a negative emission vehicle. They actually clean the air running through
them.
Oh,
my goodness.
What comes out the tailpipe's cleaner than goes in.
So when this is all said and done, you just told me that you are now one of the cleanest operations in the country, not just in the state.
Yeah, and we have the highest percentage of alternatively fueled vehicles in the Northwest. We're one of the top 4 in the country in terms of percentage of our fleet that's alternatively powered.
Wow, so there you go, folks. That is the absolute fact that our bus system is as clean as anybody. And actually, through all that, it's more efficient. You have a tremendous efficiency, and that's why you've been able to do what you've done and be able to capitalize and operate the system. It's pretty terrific. Before we go, there is some challenges. If you move forward and get larger, you might have to go out for a little more money.
Right.
And that is a tough atmosphere right now.
It is.
So you're still thinking about that.
Yeah,
that's the other political side to this
right.
thing, is going out and asking for the money.
So our board had actually put a plan for a measure for February to mm-hmm. go to the ballot. We had done about a 2-year community outreach project where we had about 70% of the population saying that not only did they want us to do more service, they were willing to pay for it.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the way we put it out there. If you want us, we've done about as much tweaking as we can do to the system on an efficiency to provide more public transit. It's going to cost more money, mm-hmm. and that requires additional sales tax. Only authority the legislature has given us is sales tax,
right.
So that's why we're looking at that. A bunch of issues came up with the timing of it, and the board pulled it back off, mainly to hold back, but right now the question is, do we go back out anytime soon? The environment here is pretty tough right now with
the property tax situation is, but that's going to get better next year. You know, those taxes will start going back down. We had that jolt this year, but it will come back down, and we'll have to see at that point. But I think that was a good move. We saw what happened to the bond issue for
yeah.
the schools, and I think it's just tough right now. Well, Richard, you've done an amazing job. This is probably the finest bus system in the state for sure, and maybe in the country, and we appreciate your work. And I think it's great that we can have both. I've said this a lot of times. Mm-hmm. You can have economy and environment, and frankly, they work together, and you've proven that. So we are going to take it out of here. We'll be right back with a wrap-up. Thanks again, Richard Durack, for being with us today and talking about a magnificent bus system. I was not a transit fan when I started this political business, but I'm becoming one quite quickly thanks to the work of this gentleman and our own system, which I think is truly efficient and obviously environmentally friendly. We'll be right back. Welcome back. Well, we're thrilled to have Richard Durack here. I tell you, we have some incredible community leaders within the 12th District. I'm always amazed at the talent when you look at Stephen Wright over at the PUD and Richard Durack at Link and a lot of the other folks, particularly in the last 10 or 15 years, we've come a long ways. And the 12th District is really on a roll in so many ways, but I really wanted you to hear about the advances in that bus system in terms of efficiency and environmental issues. I mean, there's people on both sides of those issues, but frankly, if you can have, as I've always said, a strong economy, you're going to have a clean environment, and they should go hand in hand. Well, we're going to continue with some more community shows, but in the very near future, we'll be changing some things up here a little bit. We're going to kind of go to, since I'm 2.0 now, they call me, we're going to do a 2.0 show. We'll be moving a little bit into business and economics as well as politics and changing things up, probably moving a little faster and having a little more product, I should say a little bit more information per show. We won't be so much on the single subject. We will be talking more about what's happening weekly in terms of business, economics, and politics. I'm looking forward to doing that. You'll probably see a few best of shows in the next few weeks because I'm going to be on vacation. When I come back, we'll do some film work and get to work on a little bit faster paced, more well-rounded show for you that I think you really enjoy. My background is in economics. That is what I really love to talk about, and we will dive into a lot of subjects relative to various economics, including healthcare and taxes, of course, and things like that. We can talk about the tax system, but mainly we want to broaden the show into business and economics as well. So I think we'll have a lot of fun with that. I've really enjoyed doing this. We just want to take it up one more notch, and we'll look forward to doing that in the next few weeks. Meanwhile, stay tuned. We'll keep our community programs running for another few weeks. Like I said, you might see the best of, and we'll look forward to seeing you next week here on the 12th District.
The mold of new reality.